What's up, everybody? What's up, Mavs fans? Welcome to the Mavs Vault. I am Jason Zone Fisher, and I am fired up to be here and to be joined by Mike, the Machine, Marshall. Mike, how you doing, man?
Doing great, brother. Doing great. Happy to be here. Happy to talk some Mavs, some collectibles, talk to my best friend in the world, Maxi Kleber. You know, all of the alike, man.
That's right. Mavs fans know you well. You are the king of content when it comes to the Mavs, and they know you from the Ceiling is the Roof podcast. And you also recognize our next co-host and contributor. This guy's up on the Jumbotron before all the games, dropping Mavs knowledge. Another king of the digital content for the Dallas Mavericks. We're talking about Bobby Karalla. Bobby, what's up, my man?
What's up, Jason? How are you? Happy to be here with you guys.
I am fired up. Thank you guys for being here. Thank you everyone out there for tuning in for our first ever episode of the Mavs Vault here on Twitch. This is going to be a fun show. We're going to be bringing you new content every single week, coming at you, talking about all things collectibles. You may collect sneakers. You might collect basketball cards. Maybe it's jerseys. Maybe it's NFTs and Top Shots. Everything in the world of basketball. There is so much in the fandom of it that we love to collect, and we're going to talk about that while just talking hoops, talking Mavs, have different surprise guests coming on week in, week out. It's going to be a lot of fun, and Mike, as you mentioned, your best friend, Maxi Kleber, will be joining us in a few moments here.
He could join us in a few seconds if you want.
Oh, yeah, a few seconds. Here.
All right.
Let's not make him wait then. Let's not make him wait.
All right, let's bring that man on. There he is.
What's up, guys?
Straight off the plane.
How you guys
doing?
What's
up, Maxi?
Our best friend in the world.
Yeah, you guys started without me?
Brandon said you were going to be a half hour late, so we were like, all right, we'll just keep it pushing. Yeah.
That was definitely my fault. You know, I was late to the plane, and then delays happened, you know.
Just like you. Inconsiderate, late.
Yeah.
All of the above, man.
Yeah, that's what you know about Germans. They definitely always late there.
What do you do when you're on the plane? I mean, you fly more than most average human beings. You're traveling on the road all the time. What do you do to pass the time on all these plane flights?
It really depends on the mood. You know, sometimes I'm tired and I might just like try to nap or like close my eyes a little bit. And if not, you know, I listen to music, read a book, watch a movie. Basically, everything that anybody would do on a plane.
Oh, so what'd you do today?
Today I was listening to music, just relaxing a little bit.
Okay.
It was a short flight, so, you know.
Yeah, easy. You didn't want to get into a book.
Yeah.
You said a few years ago, I think it was during your rookie year, so this is 2017, 2018, you said that Wesley Matthews, who at the time was kind of the vet in the locker room, gave you a list of American movies that you had to watch.
Yeah.
And it was like really some really basic ones that were surprising to me that you hadn't seen. So I'm just curious, how far along are you on that list? And like, what's like the most like common movie that you haven't seen yet that you're still like, man, I really got to watch that?
Well, first of all, I lost the list, so that's bad. So I don't.
Well, don't tell Wes. Jeez.
I won't tell him. But I caught up on some classic American movies. I guess one movie that I should watch, or like movies that I should watch, would be Star Wars. But I can't really get into it, so I'm probably never gonna watch it.
Not a single one.
Not a single one.
There's like 15 of them now.
I've seen one Han Solo. That's it.
You'll really upset everybody if you just jump straight to The Mandalorian and don't watch the previous 25 hours they've made.
I should do that.
And just want to talk about The Mandalorian and ask questions about like, well, why is this guy here? And what's his whole story?
Yeah.
Like that will really upset.
That will be me. That will be me. But like other classics I watch, so I'm definitely catching up on that.
Do you have a favorite movie that you've taken in a lot of American movies and film culture over the last couple of years? Is there one that stands out that you want to watch again and again?
That's tough. Movies, I don't know. There was one movie that I really loved. It was like Good Boys, you know, just like a solid laugh. I don't know if you've seen it. But like, I don't know. I think there's not a movie that I would watch over and over and over and over again. It's more with like TV shows or something like that.
Okay, well, you haven't seen Shawshank Redemption yet then. That's you just watch over and over.
No, I haven't. You guys can make me a new list now.
Oh, yes.
All right. Yeah. Leave your movie suggestions in the chat.
Don't open that door.
Everyone in the chat, throw in some suggestions.
Yes, I need a good movie list of movies that I should have seen for sure.
Nice. Well, Maxi, thank you for joining us, man. We really appreciate it. In the middle of the season, you just played last night. You just got off the plane. Now you're in Memphis, relaxing but prepping for tomorrow's game as well. And this show, the Mavs Vault, we're going to talk about all things basketball, but we're also going to talk a lot about collectibles, which could mean sneakers. Guys collect sneakers. Guys collect basketball cards. Guys are into Top Shot, NFTs, bobbleheads, jerseys. Do you collect anything, Maxi?
Not really. I mean, when I was a kid, I used to like collect Pokemon cards or stuff like that.
Yes.
Yeah. But, yeah, that's a while ago, but not anymore really. You know, I started at one point, like collecting some kind of shoes, but, I never really found anything that I really want to collect that badly. So I just didn't, pretty boring about that.
Growing up in Germany, was it strictly Dirk jerseys and like the academy sports and outdoors of
That's basically the only jersey you could get if you wanted a basketball jersey. If you go for soccer, you can definitely find different jerseys.
Yeah, for sure. Did you have a Dirk jersey growing up?
Yeah, I did. And I hate to admit it because he always made fun of it. He always said like, oh, yeah, your bed sheets were Dirk Nowitzki and my posters were in your room and all that. But I actually had a full set. I had like pants and jersey. Like the only full set that I had was a Dirk uniform.
Oh, wow.
Wow. Yeah. Well, so, it makes sense.
Yeah.
Yesterday, this video played at the game where you kind of like walked through your selection process for choosing your jersey number, and it was quite an arduous road. And what I'm curious about is you said like every time you got to a new team, like 14 was taken and then 24 was taken, like all of your choices were taken. So I'm just curious, do you want to drop names and we can like go beat those guys up or send them mean tweets or something? 42 is a cool number, but like 24 is pretty nice too. Like you kind of had to go to like your fourth option.
I had to. I mean, if you guys want to beat them up, that's fine. But, you know, I was super young back then. And obviously, as a rookie, you don't get to decide what number you get. So I had to respect, obviously, the veterans. And that's fine. You know, that's just like how it works in basketball. So I'm actually not really complaining. And I'm happy with the number that I have right now. But back then, you know, I used to have 12 and that was my go-to. But I got over it. So I'm okay now.
Okay. No, I can't beat up Derek Harper. I can't beat up Derek Harper. That's, of course, the Mavs number 12. So he's off limits to me. I respect the GOAT.
So everybody, I'm sure everyone's asked you about 25 times about the Call Me. I've moved on to like the follow-up album, like the B-sides at this point. And I want to know what the you and Dwight pregame, like ball shake back and forth competition is about. Like, what are we trying to do here? I know it's make the three at the end, but what if leading up to that, what are we trying to do?
I wish I had an explanation. So I don't know, like if you guys watch Dwight pregame, you know, he kind of gets involved with everybody. He gets everybody going. Like he's one of the greatest teammates I've ever played with, you know,
brings the juice, man.
Energy and like his, and his pregame routine is very strict. Like he has every minute is booked basically with another player. And for some reason we came up with this and I don't even know how it started, but like we added one thing, the next game another thing, and then it's just like built up to what it is now, and it's pretty funny. And you know, there was one time this video that went like a little bit viral, and that's like basically our pregame routine now that we do all the time.
Nice. All right, now you mentioned you had like a Dirk jersey when you were growing up. But I'm curious, you were there for Dirk's final season, and obviously growing up being from the same hometown and being an incredible basketball player yourself from Germany. Did you collect anything from that last season? Maybe did Dirk give you something of his, or did you steal something from his locker? Something to remember that final season by that maybe is a memento that you really cherish.
Yeah, I actually got a Dirk jersey with his signature on it. I never really wanted to ask for any of this, but I had to do it. You know, it's such a special thing to play with one of your childhood idols. So I really had to bother him with that. I don't know if he was upset or not, but I did it anyway.
Do you take it with you everywhere you go? Or
No. It's locked up in a safe, so nobody can steal it, you know?
Yeah.
Okay.
Maxi, there's more than 14,000 people watching right now, and I want to show them something, and I want to show you something, too.
I'm kind of nervous now.
No, not at all.
That's a lot of people.
Okay, so I want to share something going on here. Let's see. Because you made something the other day. I don't know if you can see this. I'm sure you can.
We'll see it now.
It's a picture of you. So all of you out there that are fans of NFTs, I know there's a lot of you, Mike, Jason. You guys are. I know I am. You can buy this thing. It's on sale. It's called Ice Cream Sundays. And Maxi, from what I understand, you're one of the people in these in this photo.
Yes.
I want you to describe what is. Well, I have my own guess. Okay. Mike and Jason, where do you guys think that he is?
I'm gonna say red shirt in the not the blonde kid, but the other red shirt.
Oh,
there.
So eyes closed, going all the way in.
Just front and center, loving that ice cream.
That's red shirt with the tilts and the smirk, cheesing for the camera with the yellow font. I think that's Max. The haircut.
Oh,
the chili bowl. I think
used to be a blonde. Maxi, can you give us a little more background information on what's going on here?
Yeah, I used to be very blonde. So actually, that's my grandma right there on the left. Then it's my little brother. Then it's me. So,
best friends. Right. Oh,
you knew it.
Then it's my cousin, my older brother, and my other cousin. Like, the cousins are, as you can see, twins.
Wow.
And we had actually a fun day. Mark explained us a little bit about NFTs, and he showed us how it works. And it was very fun to do. And actually, I wanted to use another picture, but I couldn't find it. So I had, because I had to keep up with everybody, I had to take a picture. So this is the picture I chose then. And, it's just a funny picture out of my childhood. So I'm pretty sure you guys saw the ones that Bobby, Dwight, Josh, and all the others made.
Yeah, but now yours is going to be the most expensive, which is good I think I you get
so.
A cut, but you can get one for 0.1 ETH, which, not that I keep up too much with that stuff, but Ethereum is having $1 a great day. And so, it will cost you quite a bit.
Wow.
It was just funny because Mark offered us to like teach us about it and show us how it works. And it was really interesting, like everybody was excited to just learn about it. So that was the main point of this session when we did it.
You haven't gotten into Top Shot yet, have you?
No. I should start. Yeah.
Well, there's one card that's like, I don't know, $6 to $10. And just hear me out. What if we bought all of them? Just me and you, and then drive the price up. GameStop them.
We might be broke before, but we can start. We can try.
I like this idea. Now, before there were NFTs and these moments that everyone's talking about with NBA Top Shot, there were basketball cards. Did you ever collect basketball cards when you were a kid?
No, like I said, the only thing I collected was Pokemon cards. But
good choice.
Randomly here and there, I had one of those cards, but it was never that I like purposely collected them. And I don't even know if I still have some at home. Maybe boxed up somewhere.
They're worth a lot potentially. You don't know. It's like that's your retirement right there. Yeah, exactly.
I should definitely check.
Well, we're gonna do a fun game. It's always fun to open a pack of cards, kind of like an unboxing. So we're gonna pop a pack of cards. This is from this season, all right? And we're gonna play a game. Have you ever heard of word association, where you just have to real quick say the first thing that comes to your mind, Maxi?
Ooh,
all right?
Yeah, that's
really like don't even think. You just gotta channel, like get in the zone right now, get in that flow state. We're going to open a pack of cards. I'll show you the card. I'll show you the player. And you tell me the first thing that comes to your mind when you see that.
Oh, that's scary. That's scary.
It is scary. Yeah, because we want the unfiltered, raw reaction. I don't want any canned political stuff here.
I know. But that's never good on life. You know,
it could be in German if you needed to.
Okay. I had bad experience.
Here we go. We're opening this pack live right now. And you tell me the first thing you think of when you see Mitchell Robinson.
Dunker, high flyer. I remember we played against him, and he had a pretty sick alley-oop against us.
All right. Nice. He is a dunker, high flyer, block shot. I mean, would you have any hesitation to go up against him? Like if you're, one-on-one and you want to maybe flush it, slam it in his face, but you see him there, any hesitation?
I mean, if you're on your way to dunk it anyway, you might as well just try to go through with it, or like create a foul or something like that. But yeah, lately I've, just shooting threes, so I got to work on my bounce again, I guess.
Shooting threes.
Okay.
You're shooting like 45% for most of the season, man.
Yeah, but I like dunks too, so I just like got to work on my.
We'll be watching tomorrow night. Again. Well, tomorrow night. Look out, Jonas Valanciunas. You're coming at it. All right. Here we go. Next one. First thing that comes to your mind, Dwight Powell.
Ooh.
Dwight Powell. Also
wow.
Hard worker, high flyer, perfected the dunk shot.
Okay. Nice. All right. Again, quick
reaction.
Are those
cards for me then or no?
What's that?
Yeah, you can have
those cards off. Yeah, okay. So
these are, yes, these will be mailed to you.
My first collection. I started right here.
This is it. Exactly. You can probably get Dwight to autograph this, you know? Yeah. It's like, we'll ask on your behalf.
Maybe.
Yeah,
maybe.
We'll ask I'll for see. You. Yeah.
Yeah. Okay. All right. Real quick, don't think. First thing that comes to your mind when you see Blake Griffin.
Crazy dunks.
Wow, we got a lot of dunkers.
It's yeah, like, a lot of dunkers.
So far, so far you only showed me like dunkers. You know, like
okay,
I
all right.
Lob City back then. Obviously I was in Europe watching all this stuff and
yeah.
The dunks that he and DeAndre Jordan pulled off were just unbelievable. Like I went every day on NBA just to see all the top 10 dunks because I knew they were going to be in there somehow.
That's right. All right, I'll mix it up. This guy won't be a dunker. That's okay. Here you go. First thing, Evan Fournier.
Dunker. I'm just kidding. Actually, a very skilled shooter. You know, I played against him with the national team 2 years ago now, I think. And he really gave us problems like that I haven't even seen from him like this in the NBA, but he's an amazing talent. And, you know, you can see like night by night, he's a great shooter.
Yeah, absolutely. All right, here we go. First thing you think of when
can
you
I say dunker again?
Chris Paul.
Playmaker, creative, very annoying, dirty player if he's not on your team. you know, he talks a lot and all this stuff, but obviously, as you can see right now with the Phoenix Suns, a great team leader and for sure a great teammate. So, you know, if you have him on your team, you definitely want to you know you're going to win games.
For sure. A guy like that who is known for maybe being like a dirty player, just looking for every advantage for him and for his team. What sorts of tactics does he do on the court that you're like, oh,
You know, I feel like he's talking a lot to the refs. You know, he has a lot of say there. And he's just like, I don't know, a dirty, annoying player that can like flop and like really annoy you and get like under your skin. So if that affects you, like it can affect your game or even like get you out of your game because you start having this mental game with him and argue with him and he distracts you from what you actually should do. So you got to be aware of that. And that's actually like something you would address before the game too. Like we know all the antics and stuff like that. So, but like I said, as a teammate, for sure, great. As an opponent.
And he's a killer too. You start thinking like, you start worrying about something that happened 5 minutes ago, then he's going to stick a midi right in your face and it's game over. I mean, he's so good.
And he loves trash talking too. So,
All right. Now this next guy, he's not a rookie. Dunker. So I don't know. He's not. Well, maybe he's a rookie. So I don't know if you know him that well. His name is Nick Richards. Nick Richards from the Hornets. He went to Kentucky.
Did he play against us? I don't think so, right?
I don't know.
Yeah. Let's see. I mean, he didn't play against us, so.
So no comment. No comment.
So bright future. I mean,
it's political. It's too political of an answer.
Yeah. It's political, but I didn't play against him, so I don't follow college basketball that much. So,
okay, here you go. First thing that comes to your mind. First thing that comes to your mind. Tyrell Terry.
Ooh.
Tyrell Terry, shooter. Very good shooter. Like in practices, he made some unbelievable shots against us. You know, very skilled player. Unfortunately, he's not with us right now. So. I hope he can join us soon again because I really like him. He's a great teammate too.
Cool. All right. You're doing well. One card left. It's another rookie. A lot of rookie cards. That's good for you.
And dunker, 100% a dunker. I'm pretty sure of that.
It's RJ Hampton.
He can dunk.
Yeah, dunker for sure.
I've seen him dunk.
Did you? No.
Yeah.
Yeah. He's from here, Maxi. You know that, right? He's from right up the
here
road.
In Memphis
he's
or Dallas?
Oh, from where we are from there.
Nice.
He's from Little Elm. Yeah, so he's a local guy.
Yeah. I'm always impressed with like everybody in America. No, like if you ask about a basketball player, doesn't matter if he plays in Europe or in the US, they all know where he's from and what college he went to. That's like, I don't know anything about that. So
it's the industry, man. The draft being huge, you get that introduction of like, oh, I like this guy, he's from Florida, or you know, and then he's in the league and people just quote it the rest of their lives. That's part of it, man.
I got to step up my game there.
But I feel like you can do that probably with so many of the European players that a lot of guys like, where did he play or where did he come from? Like, you know them intimately from your experience playing against them overseas.
Please don't test me now. So.
Oh, yeah. <all right. laughs>
Next time, I'm gonna go home and study, and then we can do it.
All right, bust out your map.
So Max, I know you got to go test at some point. We don't want to take up your whole evening here.
Yeah,
appreciate your time a lot.
Testing starts in 5 minutes. Yeah.
Okay. So last one I wanted to ask you is, I feel like for me and Bobby and people around the team, like if you ask a breakout player for like the last 3 years, I'm saying Maxi Kleber. Okay, and it's been true the last 3 years. Like you've evolved from just the guy that gets minutes to in the rotation to now, dude, you're a starter every single night. So what do you attribute that progress to? The three-point shooting has come along. The defense is spectacular. Just becoming basically from nothing, right? An undrafted guy coming over a little bit later in age than most of the dudes. What do you attribute your success to and just vaulting up to starter level in the NBA?
Well, first of all, I appreciate that. Second, I would put Dodo definitely in that conversation because, you know, to me, Dodo is like an amazing player who does a lot for the team that you can't see in the box score. And I would categorize myself as a player like that. You know, a lot of nights I'm not scoring a lot or not having many shots, but I have impact on the game. And definitely like the shooting helped me because, you know, just by the fact that I shoot better, teams can't really stay off of me that much, which means there's more space for Luca, KP, Tim, Jay Rich, and everybody to attack the paint, you know, which definitely helps. And I think what really helped me is just like understanding the system and playing my role, understanding what I have to do for the team, you know, playing good defense and just do the right play or make the right play every time. Obviously, I think there's a lot more I can improve and get better at. And this is definitely the goal to work on that every day. But the reason why I'm playing, I assume, is because I do a lot of other things right, you know, not just what's in the box score.
Yeah, everyone wants to talk about Luke and KP. That's granted. But to people around the team that are there every day, you know that you got to have a dude in practice that busts his ass every day. And I feel like we got four of those guys.
Yeah, I mean, like it all works together. You know, like the management and everybody around the coaching staff, they put together a team and they find like the puzzle pieces and everybody has their role. And I think if you understand your role and what you have to do, it really helps the team. And, you know, I try to get better in that. Like obviously the last years being here and having this kind of routine helped me to understand everything that's going on, what I should do, what I have to work on and what I need to get better. For example, the shooting, because, you know, I can really help on the defensive side. Even if I don't have blocks or steals, just challenge shots and switch defense and all that stuff. So, you know, understanding all that really helped. And it's, like I said, it's a lot of puzzle pieces that come together to build a good team.
Yeah, and it's a great signal to the younger dudes, too, because if you come in as a second-round pick as an undrafted guy and you think you can't get minutes or you can't make it here, look at Doe. Look at Max.
Yeah.
Look at Dwight.
I agree. You know, like, obviously, you got to be a little bit lucky, too, and I would say I was definitely very lucky on my path here. So everything worked out like that. But, you know, if you put in the work and you keep believing, you know, good things can come out for sure.
Awesome, man.
Yeah, well, great things are coming. Congratulations on all your success to this point. Best of luck with the rest of the season. And thank you so much for joining us. We really appreciate your time. And you got some NBA basketball cards.
I appreciate it.
Next to your Pokemon cards now.
That's right.
I appreciate it, yeah. Thanks for your time. And thanks for everybody listening. I hope you guys have a great rest of the talk and great night.
Thank you, Max.
Thanks, Maxie.
I love you.
Have a good one. That was weird.
say it back. Say it back. Oh, he's gone.
Oh, yeah. It got weird. Oh. He hung up on you there.
Oh,
yeah.
Man. He said it. He cut out it right
That's
there.
That's right. Exactly. Yeah. That happened. Well, Maxie is the man. I can tell why you guys do love him, why you're infatuated with him. He's not only a great player, improving year after year, but a great guy off the court as well. And it was awesome chatting with him. And that's what you can expect here on Mavs All. Every single week, we'll have different current players, former players, guests in the collectible space, talking Top Shot, cards, jerseys, autographs, game use tickets, all this stuff that is like exploding right now, these markets. And I want to do, because I know the three of us, we share a lot in common of being hoops heads, Mavs fans, and we collect a lot of crap. And we got a lot of junk and a lot of stuff that has so much value to us and to the world. So I want to play a little show and tell. And we each have brought some items from our own personal collections that we want to show off and talk about a little bit. So why don't we get into that? And before we do that, I do want to mention to everyone who's watching right now, we're going to have a giveaway later here today. There are only 1,000 limited edition Luka Doncic Mavs edition cards. And Bobby, I think you can tell us a little bit more about the card itself that exists. We are going to be giving away one of these rare Luka cards to one of you here today who is watching.
Yeah, it's worth at least $1 million, but it is really rare. There are only 1,000 of them in print, and I don't want to make any guarantees, but Mike, I believe it's a rookie card as well. So pretty awesome prize there. And it's very easy to qualify for the giveaway. All you have to do is follow our channel. So follow Dallas Mavericks. Hit the follow button. Go ahead and turn on notifications when we go live. We can't track that, but we'll trust you. Follow the channel, and then whenever it's time to give it away, you'll just have to drop a message in the chat, and that'll be at the end of the show. So stick with us through the end of the broadcast, and you might get a chance to win one of these sweet, sweet, super ultra mega hyper limited edition Luka cards to add to your collection. And then you can have a one up on Maxi, because all Maxi has is Dwight Powell and Blake Griffin. You can have a Luka. I mean, you can have a Luka.
It's actually the all NBA first team card.
Ooh, it's not even a rookie, better. So. Even better though.
But
even
super better. Rare. I was trying to share the screen on it, but it's obviously in a preview app, so that's confusing. But it says I'm not even gonna try and say the Slovenian word for equality on the back. That's hovering across the back. Luka's getting the one-legged fadeaway. There's very limited edition. Something you're gonna want if you're a collector of any kind. So yeah, that's gonna be awesome, man.
Am I eligible to win? Can I comment in
the chat? Yes, I don't know. You are.
Bobby says yes, so I'm gonna be in there too. So I'm going up against you guys. But first, before we get into the giveaways, let's see some stuff from your guys' collections. And Bobby, you've got a treasure trove that you brought here. So why don't we start with you? Because I know you cleaned out the Mavs offices a couple of years ago, and I'm super jealous.
Yeah. So I guess it's public knowledge now. I'm not sure I was supposed to take any of this stuff, but we relocated offices a few years ago. In the process, we had to get rid of a bunch of stuff. And instead of getting rid of it, I just put it in my living room. So I have all sorts of goodies. I'll just show off a couple things first.
Stole it. This is
that's the definition of stealing.
I moved it from one location to another location. Into my possession. So I won't show everything because we gotta take turns. But I want to show a couple things. So first off.
He's also doesn't want to show everything because he's not sure that
I'm implicating myself right now. So this is just a very old fashioned Mavs practice jersey. But Mike.
Who is it? What number is on it?
It's reversible.
Oh, that is so sick.
It was blue and now it's white.
And this is from judging by the color scheme and everything. This is from like early 90s, if not the late 80s, because it's this dark blue with the green lettering. So anyway, that's one thing. But then
two jerseys in one.
The juicier thing is
the first reversible jersey ever.
That is true. That's science. This beautiful, beautiful. I'll just put it on.
I'll wear that
warm up shooting shirt worn by a mystery Mav. I have no idea who it was. Normally, they have a number on the inside. But this, a short sleeve shooting shirt.
That's cool.
With, let's see, with the little M right here. Yeah.
We got to bring the shooting shirts back.
I love that.
The ones that go over, like the full on button up, like 10 different buttons. It's wool.
That is cool.
Now, if this doesn't make me look like an athlete, I don't know what will.
That's pretty sweet.
So there was no number on the shirt itself, on the shooting jacket. But here we have.
Is that why you stole it?
Yeah,
it belonged to nobody. Longest pants ever. So to give you an idea of how long these are, I'm 6'3".
Wow.
He's like 6'2".
Yeah.
This
really exaggerating.
Wow.
They have to come up to almost my neck in order to go down to my ankles.
Wow. So,
I'm assuming that these belong to a big man.
Yeah, it's like you're a little kid borrowing your dad's clothes.
It's like you went to the old school like clothier and he'd given you like the pants that come up to here for a wedding suit.
I couldn't hear anything you guys just said, so I'm gonna assume it was all compliments.
It was great.
Okay.
Yeah, it was great stuff.
But let me see. I want to investigate here because there is some type of tag in here. Normally it'll say like if it's game worn, and these are definitely game worn, but there's just no sort of identifier as to who these would be. But I know these aren't sold in the fan shop because again, you have to be at least like 7'5" in order to fit in these.
Maybe smell them. Does it smell like a player? Could you identify it by smell?
It smells.
That's Felton Spencer. That's a Felton Spencer.
Yeah, that's exactly what I was going to say. But yeah, if you're a former Mav and you're watching, which of course you are, and you believe that this is yours, let Machine know, and he will return them because he's the one that took them. I took everything else, but not this. Let Mike know, and he can get this back to you. But so this is part one of my old Mavs collection, and this is from mid-'80s, if not earlier. I've seen photos of like Roe Blackman and Derek Harper shooting around and these kinds of things before a game. And these are in the glory days of Mavs basketball. So this is some like 40-year-old stuff right here.
Wow. That's pretty cool. Now, do you, be honest, do you wear it, you know, in your apartment? Are you, when you're hanging out, what do you do with these things?
I have worn this to a Halloween one time.
Okay.
And I also sleep in every single night.
All right. Yeah.
But otherwise, never. I'd never wear it at all.
Nice. Okay.
So wondering what else you've stolen over the years.
What's that?
Huh?
Well, I didn't... everyone will have to tune in next week to see what else he has stolen over the years. We're spreading it out. He's got a lot. He's got a lot of collection. I mean, minutes before we went live, he had a whole box of stuff, and he said, "Oh, this is the wrong box of stuff."
Oh yeah. Do you want? I can keep going.
We'll space it out. Okay. I like it. That was a great start. There's some cool old school Mavs gear. I like that.
Absolutely,
Mike. Let's go to you, man. What do you have? What did you bring to show and tell for the class here today?
So I got a couple things. Bobby, if you're going to queue up that video that we got.
We have a
giant server, obviously, like most teams or organizations do. And there's just videos and tapes of things that have been digitized that came from God knows where. A VHS tape that got flipped onto a digital timeline at some point and thrown into a server folder. And I stumbled across one and it piqued my interest just because it was like a Dallas Sidekicks open. And I was like, what is this? And it was just all the opens from all the Reunion Arena teams for 1995. So if you played at Reunion Arena, this is the open that they would put into the machine and press play to hype the fans up whenever you're about to sit down and you got your popcorn, lights go out, and here we go, right? So this is the Mavs intro video from the 1995 season. And if you got it ready, Bob.
I do. Hold on to your butts.
A lot of questions.
Oh, man. I'm already fired up.
The same thing.
It's like the bat signal. AJ. That acting from MASH.
They just like rent a helicopter interior for that shot?
Yes. Oh, they're flying the basketball helicopter.
Awfully close to these buildings.
Yeah, it's not so risky. You can't fly a drone in there now.
It was a different world back then.
So I'm going to roll it again, Bob. I got a lot of questions on this.
All right, wow. I'll play it again on mute.
That was incredible. That was amazing.
Thoughts on the music. Can we talk about the track first? Because that was like watching The Matrix only like on Cartoon Network.
That was what Four Loko was in 1995. Those vibes. Yeah. So I don't know why it's the same graphics card as Die Hard, the video game on PlayStation 2, but it is. Jim... apparently,
look at his artwork. Did you see the artwork? He had like a Da Vinci hanging on the wall.
Yeah, it's just classy. It's all classy, Jim.
Look at that artwork. What is that?
Not quite looking at the light either. He's looking more at like the green building over here, but that's okay.
It got He's like, purpose. Oh, yeah. Oh, no, we got a game. I forgot there's a game right now.
Well, I figured out why we didn't win a lot of games in the 90s. The guys didn't know when they were, and we had to put up a signal in the sky to alert them or hit them on the celly.
Yeah.
I want to know what
– oh, what, there's a game? Oh, all right.
What phrase is being said to Mashburn where he goes,
oh.
Like, is that phone on? That phone can't be on. And then clearly they had the guys for 3 minutes and the rest is just hitting buttons. And doesn't seem like the foundation at Reunion Arena is very solid.
It's definitely made of jello.
That looks risky. That's why they had to move arenas, I think.
And then the chopper that is the front end is a basketball. Can we bring that back?
Wow.
Like, I think Mass Man was born in there or something.
he was the pilot initially. Look at that.
Dude, any kind of car, golf cart that is a sports ball or a hot dog, I'm on board with.
Absolutely.
Across the board.
Then the back is just like Space Jam rocket.
Like, it's a rocket.
It's got heat engines, like just blowing fire right out the back.
Very curious about the understanding of propulsion and elevation from the people that made this.
And they're about to land, and here they come. They're running out, and still the logo is...
I don't know where that is. Like, did that place right there exist at Reunion?
Wow.
I've never seen that.
That must have been... This is Reunion. I know that brick wall from Reunion. The tunnel to go out onto the floor was this very narrow, dramatic tunnel. It's where I first met Mavs Man when I was a wee lad. Yeah. It was a harrowing experience for me.
Changed you forever.
Yeah, but I do recognize that brick wall from Reunion Arena.
It's a
pretty epic final shot from CGI, like Gotham City, downtown Dallas, to this, like silhouettes against green smoke. Like, that's pretty awesome. I'm not going
to
lie.
So if you're trying to get fired up for a basketball game in the year 1995, there's nothing better than this.
I'm fired up.
Absolutely.
This is the tops. And I'm real concerned about why the players don't realize there's a game like 30 minutes before the game. But we'll skate past that. So there are like 100 of these videos.
That's incredible.
There's one that's a remake of some like flying movie where all the guys are dressed up as pilots that I found. I'll bring those to later episodes.
Yes.
But there's just an archive of nonsense that I'm going to bring every week or every time I'm on as a guest, and we're going to have fun with it.
Please. You know, how about the Mavs? You rocking the throwback jerseys this season, and there's always these, like, classic hardwood classic nights. Could they maybe use one of these as, like, to bring the team out, or would it just confuse everyone? I feel like that would get people fired up.
They started doing – I think it was either Eric or Dalton from our production team did a Sabotage, Beastie Boys song, obviously.
Yeah.
One of the most iconic songs ever. And they mashed it up with, like, old-school Reunion Arena footage and then put a little VHS effect on, like, our players dunking this year.
Cool.
It's one of my favorite videos that plays in-game right now.
Cool.
Bringing just a wholesale old intro in, I'm on board with.
Yeah.
Well, Rafa the player in the comments suggests that we recreate the video with the current roster. And so what I want to hear from you guys is which player on the current Mavs team would find out about the game by looking outside, but which player on the current Mavs team would find out from answering the phone?
Luka would get the bad signal, then Boban would get the call.
Boban gets the call. Oh, mm-hmm. Yeah, of course.
Which player on the Mavs team knows how to fly a helicopter? The best.
Ooh, just Rick. It's only Rick.
Yeah.
Rick, we know Rick is at the game like 5 hours ahead of time. He is like scheming. He's ready to go.
No, he's trying to beat traffic, so he hops in the chopper.
He actually could fly it, so you could actually really shoot him flying. He's got the pilot's license. Yeah, mm-hmm.
Yeah, that's true. We wouldn't even need to rent like a stunt double. It would just sit Rick right in the pilot seat.
He just does one take and takes off, and you're like, all right. Yeah. So I guess we're
going all the way to Memphis.
I'd like to see this. Well, thank you for bringing that to show and tell, Mike. That was incredible. Do you have anything else you'd like to share? I mean, even the jersey you're rocking right there is pretty pretty cool.
The world jersey from two All-Star games ago. Obviously, no one really got to go to this year's, so I didn't get to cop any weird stuff. And Luka wasn't on a world team. He just had the normal, you know, redone Pacers thing. But
yeah,
I'm really into the weird Luka jerseys.
Yep.
Because I know everyone has like the blue or the white or the you know, this one, the City Edition from last year, or the gold or the hardwood classic. So I've got this one, and I've got the All-Star one from last year, and I've got a Real Madrid one. Mm-hmm. So it's like the B-sides of all the Luka jerseys that I'm into. Because at some point, I'll just collect every version of them.
Yeah.
Be like, here you go, kids. Like, you're welcome.
Yeah.
This jersey is on purpose, obviously. The world one is. And so I got some cards as well.
Oh, nice.
That I brought.
I love it.
My jersey addiction started, like, really young. We talked about this, Jason, about I used to – it got to a point every birthday and or Christmas I was asking for just a list of names of jerseys that I wanted.
Yeah.
It was NFL or NBA. It was mostly NBA. And so you do end up with a lot of, like, Shaq Orlando.
Yeah, right.
A lot of Damon Stoudemire Raptors. It was just hot rookies. I just wanted their rookie jersey because I thought that was worth something. I don't know.
Yeah, right.
I wanted to impress my friends when we were playing on the, you know, at Little Elementary in Arlington. And then some of them, you end up with a Joe Smith Warriors.
Yeah, right.
You know, just jerseys. You're like, what the hell was I thinking? But that was like age probably 8 to like 15. I just asked for jerseys for birthdays, for Christmas. So I'm going to go grab some of those for future episodes. But here's two of the cards that I'm currently keeping in a little tin container for everybody. So I do still collect cards every once in a while. But here's a rated rookie. Luka rated rookie, right?
Nice. Sweet.
That's the standard.
Nice.
I don't know if that one's like too pricey. You can probably get it for under 100 if it's out there. But the Panini rated rookie Luka
for under 100.
I think so. You can check on eBay real quick. Or
yeah, let us know in the comments if someone knows, because Luka rookie card.
Yeah, I'll be watching. I'm curious.
Like the most sought after rookie cards of this current crop of players.
Yeah,
I think that's the one that's coming next. I think.
Yeah.
Yeah. If you got a mill, like I'll sell it right now.
Oh wow,
that's cool. And then this one is probably the most valuable card that I have right now. Another Panini one. This is the Class Axe Luka Red Prism 2018.
Sweet.
It's the red part that makes it rare, I think, because there are other versions of it.
Yeah.
But this one's listed for, I think, over like $3,000 or $4,000 on a couple Amazing. Different sites. So those are the two. I mean,
how did you obtain that card? Was it in a pack? Did you buy it? Did you?
No. All packs. We wow. obviously do a lot of work with Panini.
Sure.
And the jerseys that go out post-game, like I make all those, right? So if Luka has 40 points, 10 rebounds, 5 assists, I end up making that jersey, putting it out there. It's a Panini sponsorship on it. So every once in a while, they'll come through and just be like, here's some boxes. And me and Bobby just like raked them off people's desks.
Yeah, that's incredible.
So we have a ton of cards back there.
I didn't steal anything. You gave me some. I stole enough stuff already. Stop trying to accuse me of everything here.
If you do it twice, double jeopardy.
Ashley Judd. Yeah. Good point.
You know, it's totally fine.
I see why the show is called the Mavs Vault. This is the vault. This is we have like cracked into here. We call like jailbreak. Yeah.
Yeah. So I have a bunch back there. I probably need to look up what they're worth because there are some rare ones that are floating around. But the Luka ones, obviously, that's our dude. So I'm put those in the tin container right here. That's not going anywhere.
That's very good. Maybe invest in, you know, like some of these.
I got some of those.
Yeah.
I got some of those.
Right. The sleeves. That's what we need. The sleeves.
Yeah. I keep this. This is the only one I keep in a sleeve consistently is the Class Act one.
I like that. Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, that's we got to get that bad boy graded, man.
Yeah.
Jason, before you show yours, I just want to remind everybody, if you want to get in on this as well and get your very own Luka card from the Mavs, follow the channel. That's the most important thing you have to do. And then the second thing you have to do is go ahead and now, just anytime in the next 5-10 minutes, just drop a message in the chat. You can say pizza. You can say Luka. You can say, I love Jason's own Fisher. You can say, I hate machine sports. Doesn't matter what you say, as long as it doesn't violate TOS or get you banned, you will enter to win this Luka card from Panini, from the Mavs. It's going to be awesome. So go ahead and follow the channel, leave a message in the chat, and we will announce the winner live on stream before we're done.
I love it. Yeah, get in the comments right now. That is your entry. That is your ticket. So enter right now, and we will pick a winner before the broadcast is done to get your own Luka rookie card. I'm fired up. And if you say I love Jason's own Fisher in the chat, it's worth
counts two. Yeah,
counts two. Counts two. Right. Yeah. I think that's unofficial, but
if you say I hate machine sports, it counts as 10.
Wow. So. Oh man. All right. The chat's fired up now.
All I do is try and help you. That's all I try and do all the time is just help you and progress your career. And you bring this stuff to the stream.
Sorry, man.
Just nonsense.
I collect a lot of different stuff, and I have like machine when I was a kid collecting jerseys. I've gotten really into sneakers. I'm on the sneakers app and trying to collect different shoes all the time. I've collected basketball cards my whole life, bobbleheads. I got a lot. And because of what I do for a living, I've traveled all across the country and gotten to attend a lot of sporting events. And I keep even game used tickets. So one, actually, I didn't prep this. I just realized that I got it. But today is a special day. So hold on. I'm going to find it right now. Because 5 years ago today, was Kobe Bryant's last game.
Ooh,
ever played.
That's right. That's
and
right.
I was at that game.
Oh, wow.
This is the ticket. And I just looked this up. Apparently, these tickets are going for thousands of dollars. I think $2,000 each. This is Kobe's last game ever, where he drops 60. And it's crazy. You know, people used to yell at me, my mom, saying I'm a hoarder because I save stuff. But this just proves it makes sense to save things. You never know what will be historic.
Yeah, dude, that night had to be just obviously, I mean, one of the best experiences of sports history.
It was incredible. I've been very fortunate to attend a lot of big sporting events, from NBA Finals games to All-Star games and All-Star weekends. And a game that really there was nothing on the line. The Lakers weren't good that season. The Utah Jazz had just been eliminated from playoff contention. It was sort of a meaningless basketball game, but it meant so much to everyone who was there. A farewell tribute to Kobe Bryant. The energy and atmosphere in that arena, because Kobe started the game missing everything. It was like ugly for the first 6 minutes. And I think people were worried, like, this is going to be an awful last game and like a sad way to go out. And then he just turned it on, and he wouldn't let them lose the game. And he also wouldn't pass the ball, and no one else would shoot. They said, you have to shoot. And the energy kept building and building and building as he kept hitting shot after shot, and the place erupted. It felt like you were winning the championship, just rooting for this to continue. It really was one of the best sporting events I've ever been to in my entire life. It's
insane how, number one, how good players like him are in general, but how they can raise their level of play to just a insane level. Like Dirk's last two games, he didn't have anything left, right? He was like, let's get to the end of the season. Okay, it's my last home game. I'm going to light it up.
Yep.
It's my last game against San Antonio. I'm going to light it up.
Yep.
And whenever that little bit of extra motivation, the Michael Jordan, you know, I took that personally thing.
Yeah.
We get these guys that are the best in the world, and you motivate them just like a degree, turn it up to 11, just a touch. Dude, they go ham. And it was crazy seeing Dirk's last one, and that wasn't even on the level of Kobe's last game.
No, but even that was special. He brought it. He played up, like, just like you said. He channeled it, and the tributes that took place in that game. So for any Mavs fans out there, if you have that ticket stub, it's worth something. It really is. And look into getting it graded through PSA, because that's what authenticates it. And it's, even if you're not going to sell it, you just want to keep it as a memento for yourself, it still just encapsulates that moment for you. And it's a good way, as opposed to, you know, just keeping it in a tin, which, you know, no judgments. It's I need to get my card graded too, because I really want it to just be cemented and safe and protected. And it's something that I think will only continue to go up in value over the years to come, you know.
I appreciate the digitizing of the cards and how convenient it is. Not the cards, the tickets. Now and how convenient it is, but man,
sure. I know
nothing hits quite like here's my tickets. Here's
exactly.
The tickets.
Something, they look so cool. They feel so cool when you first get it. The images on it, the memories. I know. And that's actually, it's interesting, because that's, you know, basketball cards that had that same feeling for so many people. Mm-hmm. And now it's transitioning to the world of NFTs. It's all digital, right? Top Shot. But we found a way. I think the key for me with Top Shot and why I am into it is that you can get a pack, and you still have that feeling of you don't know what you're going to get. You're going to crack open something. So it still has that moment. And even though it's not tangible, you know, you can't touch it, you still feel it and you own it, because you don't know what you're going to get. And that's what's so fun about opening packs of cards. And you still have that with Top Shot. Which
that reminds me, I still have an unopened pack in my collection right now, the pre-order one from a couple weeks ago. So
we can pop that
bad boy too.
We can pop those in a minute.
I think let's pop those in a minute. I do want to show you one other thing here. I've got a lot of stuff, and we'll spread it out over the coming weeks. But this is pretty cool. This is a pair of game worn shoes by Sean Kemp. Sean Kemp, the Rain Man, he signed them too. Now, I'm a Mavs fan who grew up in Cleveland, Ohio. I'm a Cavs fan, a Mavaliers fan. And when Sean Kemp came to the Cavs, I was able to get these. So these are not from the Sonics era. These are his first year in Cleveland with the Cavs. The DMX Reebok shoe here. Sean Kemp, the Rain Man. Game worn.
I literally bought Sean Kemp Cavs jersey less than a week ago online.
Yeah.
Just to have it. Because they're hard to find. Like, you can't find, like, the actual jersey anymore on, like, Mitchell and Ness or anything. The Sonics jerseys are becoming extinct. Like, their price is just going insane. You can't get it, like, for $130. Like, if I wanted to get one at our fan shop, of an authentic one, you know, $130 range, all the Sonics stuff is through the roof.
Yeah.
But the Sean Kemp was my dude. Like, I was so happy whenever you brought this up. Like, he's the reason I started watching basketball.
Nice.
Like, Mavs weren't good back then. I would watch, you know, SportsCenter, and, like, I would practice SportsCenter in my backyard when I was, like, five, and, like, read a script and stuff. Every time I watched, I could not wait until they had Sonics highlights on. Because that man, I don't know how or why or what his body construction was that allowed him to fly and just contort like that, man. It was different than anybody else that had ever done it before and ever has. Like, his dunks were so creative, so fluid. Every body part's, like, has its own angle. Like, it's a work of art to watch Sean Kemp dunk.
And so powerful, too, because it wasn't just pure finesse. He had creativity. He had style. But he had power, too, almost like Zion. Zion's obviously even more of, like, a football player body than Sean Kemp, young Sean Kemp was. But he just had such power and style and swagger. And then him and Gary Payton together, I mean, they were the perfect complement to one another. They really were 90s NBA at its best. There's a great documentary, actually, that was on NBA TV recently about the Rain Man and the Glove, and I highly recommend you guys check it out. It just encapsulates what that era of basketball was like, what that duo was like, and it brought so many people all around the country. You didn't have to be a Sonics fan. It just brought them to the game of basketball, like you, Mike, you know?
Went around the world, too. Don't forget, Dirk grew up watching Sean Kemp. He was playing in Seattle alongside Detlef Schrempf, two guys that were at Dirk's last game as kind of honored speakers.
That's
so,
Dude, that was – I about melted whenever we were doing this interview with Dirk 2 years ago, and he says, you know, Barkley, Jordan, Detlef, obviously, and he lists Sean Kemp as one of his five favorite players ever. And I'm like, whoa, okay, that's awesome to begin with. And then his final game, final home game for Dirk, all those guys, so Larry Bird, Detlef, Scottie Pippen, Barkley, and Sean Kemp get invited. And they're like, oh, these guys are going to show up. Some of them are going to be there. Barkley will be there, obviously, because, you know, he's tied in with the TNT stuff. And they were like, we don't know if Sean Kemp will be there. And then Sean Kemp gets back to us. He's going to be there. I get to go into that room with Larry Bird, Charles Barkley, Scottie Pippen, Sean Kemp. And all the other guys, I'm like kind of holding my composure in a little bit. Like Larry Bird, I was kind of like melting a little bit interviewing him. And then it gets to Sean Kemp, and he just gives me a big hug, and he's like, how you doing, man? Having a great time. Love this place. And I'm like,
cool.
I can't speak to Sean Kemp. I can't explain what Sean Kemp meant to me to him. And I'm just like, man, thank you. And it was like the coolest night. It was the coolest.
That really was. That was one of the best. I mean, now you see this all the time when D-Wade retired. Dirk, obviously Kobe's swan song. But what the Mavs organization did on that night for Dirk Nowitzki, that was the best final game tribute video presentation, just experience that I've ever seen. It really was phenomenal, start to finish. It was whoever produced that from the Mavs team, they should go produce the Oscars this year. That was
good job, Mike.
There was like 50 people. That was a tiny little piece of it.
Yeah. How surprised was Dirk? Did Dirk know that everyone would be there in person?
No idea.
It was like the number of people that knew that those five guys were going to be there, not counting those five guys, was like, I don't know, what, 9 or 10 people knew about it, Mike?
Maybe fewer than that.
Yeah, Cuban, a couple people that worked in this office. I mean, it was a very, very, very well-kept secret.
Wow. Yeah, it was the people that needed to make the phone calls to get those people there and the people that were going to have to capture it. So, you know, it's like 7 or 8 people.
Yeah,
that's incredible. And they wanted to give Michael Jordan. He had a previous thing, or I think he didn't want to look like he was choosing sides between D-Wade. And Dirk, which, you know, respect for that. But getting those guys in a room together, like if I could have just set a camera and just watch Pippen, Barkley, Bird, Sean Kemp just bounce off each other for the entire game. They're just hanging out in Cuban's bunker the entire game. I'm like, oh my God, man.
That's amazing. Yeah. That's so cool.
Never ever forget it, man.
Wow. All right. Well, we could talk for hours, but like we said, we're going to be here every week doing all sorts of show and tell, talking all things hoops, collectibles, Mavs. But before we get out of here today, make sure that you are commenting, because we are going to give away a Luka card, a limited edition card, to one of you if you've commented in the chat and you have subscribed to this channel. But first, we've talked a lot about NBA Top Shot, sort of alluded to it. Bobby, you mentioned that you got a pack and you have not opened it yet. So I want to see you get this like rare Luka moment live right now with us in front of everybody.
All right. All right.
I'm putting good juju, good vibes. Mm-hmm.
Let's see what I can do. Let's see what I can do here.
If you could pull any moment, Bobby, who would you want? And is there one moment that maybe you don't want?
Well, you know, it's a base set. Right. Okay. So it's not going to be anything rare, but right. Still any Mavs, three thumbs up, any Spurs, any Rockets. Who else beat the Mavs recently? Any 76ers?
Yeah. Right.
10 thumbs down. We don't need any of those. So let's open this thing up. I don't know if we'll be able to hear any audio or anything, but
I don't think we'll hear the audio. Which is very loud if you've ever opened a Top Shot.
It's very loud. Here we go.
All right, I'm fired up.
If it's going to work.
Man, this
will it work?
This is
on the internet. I have the winner to the giveaway right here as well, too.
Oh, very nice.
Maybe we should just announce the winner. Wow. I'll mess with this.
Mess with that and see if you can get it up to the page where we'll see what the cards are before you reveal the moments.
Okay. Unfortunately, don't think that's going to work because it just opened. No. Oh, hey. Well, I got a couple good moments, actually.
Did it just show up in your pocket?
Yeah, they just showed up.
Let's see. You got to share it, man. All right, let's see.
Let's see. So we got the ones that I already have. I have a bunch of Mavs moments. I have a whole Mavs collection. I literally own all Mavs moments. But
wow, you got a lot of Luka moments.
I know. I don't want to talk about those right now. I got a Malik Beasley. Nice little move. Malik Beasley. He almost single-handedly beat the Mavs. This is about a month ago.
Went off.
Yeah, Minnesota came to Dallas. Dallas was up like 20 in the fourth quarter with like 4 minutes left. And Malik just hit like five threes in a row. They nearly came back and won. Here's a guy.
Two All-Stars.
Here's a guy who might end up playing against the Mavs next week. Anthony Davis. Oh, get out of the way. Who's the guy? Is that Gallo?
That's a great pull.
Ooh, Gallo just made a business decision there.
Yeah.
I don't need any part.
A pretty low serial number on that. I mean, it's not bad.
It is. Yeah. What is this? 35,000? Ooh.
35,000.
Nice. Okay.
Yeah. Work with that.
And then Draymond Green. Let's see what this against the Mavs? Man.
Against the Mavs.
All right, who wants this? send me a whisper on Twitter. I'll just give it away. Yeah. Was this the night that Kelly Oubre did what Kelly Oubre does, or was this the other game?
I don't know. I'm going to say it's the other game.
Okay, good. All right, we don't speak of that night. Wow. Yeah. So not bad. Not a bad pack.
That'll work.
Yeah, I'll take an AD for sure.
Yeah.
Yeah, absolutely. That's 6,000.
Yeah, I can't complain about that.
You got a good collection going there, but I know you don't want to. You know, people are going to be coming after you.
Yeah. So here's my show. Well, we don't need to. I don't want to play it. How do I just show it?
Just play it. It's fine.
Here we go. Well, it's 10 moments. It's basically every Mav moment from this season, and then there's a couple from last season sprinkled in there too. So
incredible.
I had to do it. I'm a company man. You know, I'm a company man. And on the off chance that Luka or Jalen or Josh or KP or Dwight or Josh or Maxi or Willie or Dorian or Tim are watching and they want to buy their moment from me, we can do business.
Oh,
you know,
you got them all, but you're open for business. You're open to partner.
Always, always, okay. Always. Yeah.
He's been doing this.
Yeah, I'm a businessman and a businessman. okay. You want me to announce the winner?
Yeah.
Yeah. Drum roll. One of you, thank you, everyone, for tuning in to our very first episode of Mavs Vault. We really appreciate you being here and coming back. We're going to have lots of giveaways throughout the season, but we want to reward one of you right now. So, without further ado, Bobby, let's make this dramatic.
All right, your winner of the Luka card is Night Owls 6410. So, Night Owls, if you're watching, I guess we'll probably send them a whisper, I think. Yeah, we'll be sending you a whisper. So just get back to us with some of your information and we will we'll ship that bad boy to you. Congratulations. And again, yeah, thank you. I just want to echo what Jason said. At its peak, there was like almost 25,000 people watching the stream, which is just incredible. We had a lot of fun, obviously, with Maxi, without Maxi too. So I had a blast. And thank you to both of you guys for being on here with me and for letting me be a part of it.
Of course. Well, this was all a big ruse. This was the Mavs asked us to do this just so we could see what you've been stealing from the organization.
Oh, no.
So, we've now just uncovered that, and human resources will be escorting you out.
Man, okay. Well, if I have to go down, I might as well go down being a celebrity.
So yeah, we're going to leave this place in cuffs tonight, so just be ready for that.
Jeez.
Totally.
All right.
We're going to do this every week or something like this every week. The collectibles side, the Mavs Vault, what Jason's going to be hosting every week. We might get some Soroy brothers on here. We might get some more players. We might get a box from our physical archive that is focused on one player. Maybe Rolando Blackman. Maybe Sean Marion. Have them open items that they used to have on the team. It's going to be awesome. Really looking forward to it, guys.
Really cool stuff. So thank you all for being here. Mike and Bobby, thank you guys for bringing your show and tell and all of your enthusiasm, energy, knowledge, and Mavs expertise to the table. A huge thank you to Maxi Kleber again for spending so much time with us. And, of course, thank you to everyone out there for tuning in and watching. Make sure to follow and subscribe here. Follow all of us as well and, of course, the Dallas Mavs because we will be back again every single week with new content coming to you fresh right here on the Twitch channel. Stay plugged in and let us know what you want to see too. Comment, hit us up on Instagram, on Twitter. We'll chat with you and let us know what you want to see, what you want us to do. We got a lot of packs to pop. We got a lot of Top Shot moments to open. It's going to be a lot of fun and we're excited to be doing it with you here on Mavs Vault. I'm Jason Zone Fisher. Thank you guys for joining us. Episode 1 is in the books, and we will be back again soon.